the Lord, church? We're just going to pray over the service, and we're going to pray that God has his hand over every need, over every member of the worship team, that he uses them to help his spirit move, that he moves on pastor, and he opens us up to receive that word that God has for us. So let's pray. In Jesus' name, I pray right now that you move in this service in a mighty way, just like you did this morning. I pray that you have your hand over each and every need in this building. I pray in Jesus' name you have your hand over our worship team, God, that you use them to help your spirit move in this place. I pray in Jesus' name that you move over pastor, God, use them to deliver your word exactly how you intended to deliver it today. And I pray that you open us up to receive that and to receive your spirit and let your glory move in this place in a mighty way. In Jesus' holy name, I pray. Amen.
Water you turned into wine, down in the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you.
Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God, oh our God, our God is healer. Obstacles can dissolve right in the midst of our praising the Lord. Why? because he inhabits our praise. And what a righteous and a holy God he is. And so all that is not of him, he tends to burn away as we praise and worship him. What a great God we serve. Let's just raise our hands before we pray and love him one more time. Lift your voices to him. Hallelujah. Amoria Santa. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise your wonderful name. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your love and for your kindness. We thank you for this opportunity that we have to lift you up in the congregation of the righteous, to offer to you the calves of our lips, sacrifices of praise and thanksgiving. We invite you here to be comfortable here in our midst, Lord. So if there's any changes to be made, help us to make them. Make them within us. We give you permission, Lord God, to conform us, to change us, to do what is necessary in our hearts and our lives. You know us better than we know ourselves. Be in our midst, and we will give you all the glory. We will give you all the praise. Speak to us this day as the pastor will come forth and as other actions take place. Be in our presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Praise God.
The mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being moved. God, we believe. Yes, we can see it. The wonders are still what you do.
Miracles happen.
Lord, for all you've done. We thank you, Lord, for your presence that we feel. Lord, we ask you, Lord, to lay in our hearts this day what you want us to give. Lord, we know we can never outgive you, Lord. We just want to be obedient to your word, Lord. We want to trust in you, Lord, as we hear your voice, Lord. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. Just lay this number on our heart this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can come and march. Brother Brad's in the back. You can give electronically. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord, once again for this day and your presence that we felt. Lord, we lift this offering up to you, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to bless it, Lord. Multiply it, Lord, like the fishes and the loaves. Far beyond these walls, Lord, we pray. We give you all the praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, our children's church can be dismissed. Sister Jasmine, thank you. Hold on a minute. Okay. All right, go ahead.
We exalt thee. We exalt. Oh.
Service. The holidays are over. We enjoyed them, time with family, but we as a church, we got to get busy. You know, Satan doesn't rest. Satan doesn't take holidays. And God's going to speak to us today. Thankful to have a pastor that listens to the voice of God and seeks the mind of God for his word. And like I say, it's the last Sunday of the year, last Sunday service. And I really feel that our church has grown in many ways. And a lot of churches really fell back. And that's because of our leadership and our shepherd. Because we follow him as he follows the Lord. Amen. So I'm anxious to hear what he has for this afternoon. Pastor Arbery.
Best as always. Hope you had a wonderful Christmas. And yeah, we did. The Lord's good. Amen. Kept his hand on us. Yes. I didn't even know my wife was going to be here. Hello. You see how much we see each other on Sundays? Anyway, it is good to be here. I appreciate what the Lord has done. I personally appreciate the message this morning. Certainly not because I preached it, because the Lord really stirred my spirit with it for several days. And I woke up early this morning and my spirit was stirred. And what I believe God is doing is I believe the Lord is trying to equip us and prepare us as we journey into the next year. You know, nobody, I see a lot of people seem like they may have a Christmas hangover, they didn't make it, but I'm glad you're here. I want you to hear this. Nobody knows what will befall us this upcoming year. Things may go the way we want them to go, and things may get 100 times worse. We don't know. And if you choose to just believe, only believe in optimism, an optimistic outcome, that's fine. I've not really found life to be optimistic all the time. We can choose to be optimistic even in very difficult and strenuous circumstances. We don't allow those circumstances to control us. But the fact is, we all have to walk through places. And sometimes they're dark places. David preached about it. He taught us about it, actually. The apostles taught us a lot about it. It's all in how we handle it. I've always said, Paul and Silas, the reason they could worship the Lord at midnight in the inner prison was because they understood true joy. And true joy is not driven by circumstances. Some people fall apart the very moment things start go wrong in their life. They just fall apart in the stitches. And that's never what God has ever purposed. That is a very sure sign of carnality. It really is. When things go wrong, and it just, you know, I think about years ago, I'll try to keep standing along. He calls me up one day and he says, and again, you'll learn, I may share these stories with you 1,000 times. Just pretend and go, oh, if you've heard it. He calls me up and he says, oh, bastard. And he was like 24 years old at the time. I'm not going to make it today. Why now, Greg? Oh, you're not going to believe it. I was backing out my garage. And I wasn't paying attention. I knocked the mirror off the car. And so I'm sitting there and I'm like, are you going to tell me why, Greg? And he stops. And I'm sitting there and I'm waiting. What happened? You backed out in the street. Somebody hit you. What? I'm like, okay. Well, I just got frustrated and I pulled back in. I'm like, dear God, if knocking a mirror off your car is going to cause you to not go to church that day, brother, you got a lot of problems. You better pray to God you don't stand next to Paul. That's for sure. But what happens is, okay, I'll probably get you all messed up at me this morning. We're just not always as spiritual as we think we are. That's all. We're not. And sometimes we're just as carnal as the day is long. We just don't want to admit it. And, you know, God has a way of working those things out of you. You know, what I'm saying, it's going to kind of flow here. So let me read a text to you so you don't have to stand forever. I'll read the first. It's only one verse. That way you can sit. Job 13 and 23. It just says, how many are mine iniquities and sins? Make me to know my transgression and my sin. Period. End of story. I'd like to preach to you on this topic this morning, if I may. Unraveling the mystery. And Brother Jerome is going to pray for us again.
Lord, we thank you for your presence. And thank you, Lord, for what you've already done this morning. We pray that your presence would just flow heavily through here. God, use Pastor today. Let him preach the word, God, that you have given him, Lord, the way that you want to preach. I pray that we've come in here with an open spirit, an open mind, Lord, ready for this word, and to be able to impart it into our everyday life, God. Lord, we thank you and we glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You can be seated. Doesn't that shirt look great on my wife? Maybe guess who bought it? That's right, I picked that out. Plus a bunch of other things. Can I meddle for a couple minutes? My message was put together literally 4 minutes ago. So if it flops, you'll know why. I don't know about all of you, but I can tell you, in my life, I have just spent a lot of time trying to figure myself out. Right. Now, some people are—they're too inebriated on others, and they're too worried about everybody else and what somebody else is doing, what somebody else said, and how something. But I've just never been that way. I mean, I have a lot of flaws, and most of them will go to my grave with me, and that's the truth. But being critical of myself has never been one of them. And, you know, I've always had a hard time trying to figure myself out and understanding why and thus and this and that. And, you know, I mentioned at times before, I had a big issue when I got into church. I would always get hurt at my pastor. And when I did, it'd be about every 7 months, I got really hurt at him. And I wouldn't talk to him. I couldn't even talk to him. I'd walk right by him in church. And one day I told him, I said, I just want you to know, I said, I don't like feeling this way. I don't know why I feel this way. I hate that I feel this way. But it's not because I want to feel this way. I wanted to make sure he understood. I know I got problems, and I had a lot of them. And I know that I got struggles. And half of them, only Jesus himself knows how to fix me. And that's the truth. I said, but it's not what I want. You know, this is not my desire. It's not my choices. And I'm concerned that we live in a time where people are too afraid to analyze themselves. I'm concerned that we live in a time where we have as we read this morning, I don't remember who it was, maybe Jeremiah or Nehemiah. It was one of the two. He said that, oh God, I got to find the scripture now because I'm not going to find it taking too long. It'll come to me. I know the one I want. I just can't think of how to verbalize it. So anyway, we're always hiding under we're hiding under education. And we're hiding under our attire. And we're hiding under our level of degrees. And we're hiding under, you know, our IQ. And we're hiding under, you know, our job. We're hiding under our status in society. All of these things, we're hiding under them. And I'm not saying this is a blanket statement, but we don't allow the Lord to deal with just us. Right. Just me.
Right, yeah.
Just me. And so because of that, I'm always pointing the finger at somebody else. And I'm always hurt at somebody else. And I'm always offended at somebody else. But in reality, the problem is, it's me. It's just me and myself.
Right, right.
But I don't think we are responsible enough sometimes to be able to just look in the mirror. Michael Jackson sang my favorite song ever. And I love Michael Jackson.
Amen.
And his song was, and I loved his music because his music was very personal.
Yeah.
And you could feel him in his music. And he said, I'm starting with the man in the mirror.
Right.
And not just a great song, but what a great message.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, not to wake up every day grumbling and bittering at the world, but looking at the mirror, looking at myself, and what do I see?
Yeah.
What do I see? And when we can be honest with ourselves, when we're by ourselves, we're not amongst crowds of people, we're not in groups, we don't have to confess anything before anybody, we would admit we got a lot of problems. We've got a lot of issues. I tried telling somebody this morning, I have learned over the years that Christians are just a bunch of people with a bunch of hidden problems walking around that don't talk about them. That's all we are. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The fact is, we're not perfect beings at all. And the fact is, we all fight. I don't know about you, but I'm Jacob. I fight myself. That's what the Bible says. He wrestled with a man
And the man, we know, was an angel of the Lord, but I believe the man, to him, it was himself. He struggled with himself in that struggle, and that's why the angel asked him what his name was, because he had to come to terms with reality of who he was. Fact of the matter is, yes, I'm Jacob. I'm a man of promise, and God is going to bless my seed and blah, blah, blah. But I've got to come to grips with the fact that I deceived my brother and I stole from him wasn't mine. And I'm a horrible human being, and so on and so forth. But sometimes we're just not able to say those things.
Yeah, right.
And I don't know about you folks, and I don't know what you see every day or what your prayer's about. But one of my pinnacle prayers is this: God, help me to have to show the same level of mercy that I want you to show on me. That is one of the things that drives me. I can't explain it to you. It drives me. It's a passion of mine. Because I know in my heart of hearts that I'm not a perfect human being. And I don't want God to judge me with the judgment that I'm meeting out on somebody else. I don't want God to hold things over my head because I won't let somebody else go of the things that they have done or their past or the mistakes that they have made. But I want God to see me as a good, honest individual that has good, honest problems. And some days I don't feel like a good individual, and I'm probably not on the grand scale of things, but because of the mercy and the grace of God, that kind of overshadows all of that, and that becomes my hope. It becomes the thing that I hold on to. But when I pray this prayer, Elder, I pray it knowing that it will come back on me. So now, when it comes time for me to show compassion and mercy to somebody else, in the back of my mind, how do you want God to deal with you? That's you. What do you want God to do? And so I'm like, oh, you know, I love you. I love everybody. You know, it's okay. Don't worry about it. You robbed the bank. It's all good. I'll visit you in jail. No problem. The Bible says, "But whatever measure ye meet, it shall be measured unto you." And so the most important thing for me as a child of God is I've got to be able to look at myself and unravel the mystery of me more than anything else in the world. Unravel the mystery of who I am, and unravel the mystery of my struggles, and unravel the mystery of my pains and my sorrows and my heartaches and the things that define our character. They define us. Experiences life define us. Heartbreak defines us. Heartache defines us. Mistakes define us. Things people have done to us define us. That's why someone will tell you the only person you hold in prison by not forgiving is yourself. Because right. You become a prisoner to that moment. And right. That moment tends to become a part of your life every day.
Yeah. All right.
Best thing I ever heard my bishop say, Brother Pastor, he's still alive. He said, when I have a couple or a family or whoever come to our church from another church, he said, the first thing that I do is I bring them to my office, I sit them down, and I tell them, I'm not your pastor. I don't know what happened over there. I don't know where it went wrong, but I'm not him. Meaning, in people's minds, when they make a jump or a change in their minds, we're always justified. I mean, all the ways of a man are right in his own eyes. That's just a fact. So everything we do, we're right about. It takes a pretty big individual to really look hard at themselves. And he knew that whatever it was that drove them out of there, they view him the same way. I had a lady come into our church years ago, and she told me how her pastor abused her emotionally. I still never figured all that out, because she went back there a couple years later. He must not have been too bad of an abuser. You're just a sadist or something. I don't know. And so I knew that's exactly how she looked at me. It's exactly how she viewed me. Well, and if something was similar, if something was said that resembled her old church or her old pastor, anything at all, she would bring them side by side, and she would see them through the same lens. Yeah. Wounded people do not look at the world through eyes of understanding. They look at the world all through the same eyes. If you have been abused, I promise you, almost everybody you look at is an abuser. Everybody. Because you can't get it out of your system. If you've been cheated on, every man's a cheater. Every man. No matter what, and you hear women out there bashing men, because that's why, because something happened to them, and every man is the same way. But all in all, it all still comes back to the mystery of who I am. And it comes back to the mystery of me. And I've got to be able. Job was able to pray this prayer. And he said, how many of my iniquities and my sins? This after his good dear friends are telling him that he's in this situation because of his transgressions. And he knows he had done wrong. But maybe he decided to take an opportunity and say, God, well, if by chance there is something that I did, at least let me know about it. I hear what they're saying. I feel like I've been honorable and noble. I feel like I've lived a life of righteousness, but make me to know my iniquities and my sins. Show them to me and let me know my transgressions. I don't care what anybody else says. Let me see me. Let me unravel the mystery of me, and maybe the end of this thing will come about.
Yeah.
So for me, my greatest battle, honest to God, was me. I know we say those things, and I know, thank you, and I know we preach them. But the fact of the matter is, do we really believe it? And for me, man, I had to figure myself out. And then this broken, wounded young man starts pastoring. And I look at the beginnings of my pastoring the way I did the beginnings of my marriage. I think, oh God, why did they stick with me? And that's the truth, too. That's really the truth. Watch this. So, years ago, I was fumbling through some things today, and I came across a couple things that tells me I need to go back to my notes more often. But this is something the Lord spoke to me. I don't remember when. It had to be about a year or two ago. And the Lord said to me, he said, look at them. He said, everyone has a different desire. Some seek their own things. Some seek the things of God. Focus on those that seek the things of God. And I came across that, and it just kind of pulled at me, at my heart this morning. Because really, this is something the Lord spoke to me at a very specific time. But the same still stands true every single day. Everyone has a different desire. Some seek their own things, and some seek the things of God. And just the way of life. But the bottom line is, as a child of God, the most important thing that I would ever do as I grow in my walk with God, and if I'm still breathing, I should still be growing. The most important thing I should ever do is unravel the mysteries in my own life and unravel the mysteries about my own self. God, why do I feel, I realize I hate this girl, but why do I hate her? I understand what she did, but that doesn't give me a reason to hate, because they persecuted you, and they put you on the cross, and you prayed for them. So why do I feel this way towards this person? What is it about me that is messing me all up and is prohibiting me from being the person that God wants me to be? Because I want to tell you something. If you're a teacher in any way, shape, or form, a Sunday school teacher, if you're a youth teacher, if you're a pastor, it doesn't matter what you are. You can't take that personality to the people that you're teaching, because you'll teach them your own passions and your own feelings and your own emotions, and you'll wind up messing people up in the process. Another one of my mysteries I unraveled over the years is I realized that came about with a tough lesson. Had a guy in our church, and their marriage was a mess. And I don't know if he was talking to me before service one night. I think he was talking to me before a Wednesday night service. And he said to me, Pastor, I really need to get there, man. I need someone to beat me over the head. And I thought about that, and I thought, man, I hope that's not what he's coming anticipating. And feel like, well, if I need to get beat over the head, I can go to PCC. I'm serious. It messed me all up. And so I began to pray, and that was a pivotal moment in my life. And I said, God, I know the message is the right message, but I'm not sure if the delivery is the right delivery. So I need you to help me with the delivery. But what I could have done was get mad at this man and say, that's ridiculous. Nobody's beating you over the head. What are you talking about? Who beats you over the head? Don't act stupid. You know, I preach good things and blah, you know, I don't know. But I used it as an opportunity to unravel something in my own life. And then going back before that, I called a lady in the church one day, or she called me, I don't know. She called me and she says, Pastor, can I ask you a question? And I said, sure. She said, no, I don't want you to get upset or anything. But and she goes on with her question. I'm okay. And while she's saying that, honest to God, I hate to even admit this, but my blood pressure goes, oh, that's so stupid. I don't want you to get upset. That's so stupid. Why are you upset about it? Honest to God, I did. 1 hour later, another lady in church calls me and she says, Pastor, I want to ask you something, but I don't want you to get upset. And right then now, I felt like the Lord go. And I'm like, man, is that what's happening? Do I come up upset and frustrated? Well, I know I did. I look back, and I was a very frustrated person because I still had overcame a lot of my own sins or heartaches or experiences of the past. And I was living in frustration, and it was coming out. And I thought, my God, two people, 1 hour apart, there's a message here. There's a lesson. I need to figure out this lesson. I can keep getting mad at them, but obviously there's something to this thing. Somebody comes to you, and they tell you they're afraid to talk to you because you're always flipping out. You ought to listen to them. Somebody comes to you and says, hey, you know what? You know, do me a favor. Don't get mad at me. You always just don't get mad at me. It's so stupid. Why do they always say that? Well, that's why. Somebody comes to you and says this or that or whatever. Embrace those moments because sometimes other people are the ones that will teach the teacher. Sometimes it's those little things, the little children, the little messages they send, the little things that they say that teach us how to be good parents. But it's a lifetime of unraveling a mystery of who I am. If we are to do exactly what God has purposed us to do, and that is to live a life that is not only pleasing to God, but fulfilling the will of God in our lives, that means I've got to get myself right to do this thing. It's not about my position or my pulpit. It's about how I represent Jesus Christ to the rest of this world. It's about how I represent myself as a child of God. David wrote it well in Psalms 39, verse 1. He said, I said, I will take heed to my ways that I sin not with my tongue. I will keep my mouth with the bridle while the wicked is before me. I was dumb with silence. I held my peace even from good. My sorrow was stirred. My heart was hot within me. While I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue. In case you didn't catch that. He was angry and frustrated. And then he spoke. I try to tell people the worst time to speak is when you're angry and frustrated. I had to hang up with my sister the other night. Hung up on her cold turkey. Called me up out to somebody's house. And she's yelling so loud, I haven't talked to the girl in years. She won't come to church, she won't come around the family. And I'm trying to talk and click, goodbye. You know, I don't want to return in kind what you're bringing to me right now. And I did text her and said, I'll talk to you, but I'm in someone's house, you're yelling, I can't understand you, they can all hear you. Right. She tried to tell our mom that she didn't do that. Well, you ask everybody else in the house, we were visiting somebody. What's my point? My heart was burned, my heart was hot within me while I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue. Lord, make me to know mine end and the measure of my days, what it is, that I may know how frail I am. I think this is a verse that every Christian should print out and hang on their bathroom mirror. I got a thought that I wrote down some time ago. I thought I'd preach someday. Maybe I'll just give it to you now. And the thought was just simply, are you rapture ready? Is what you're doing right now, how you're living, how you're acting, are you ready for the rapture? Are you ready? Should the Lord come back for his church right now? And in order to be, in my opinion, to be rapture ready, we have to always watch and pray lest we enter into temptation. Because the Spirit indeed is willing, but But the flesh is weak. Period. The flesh is weak. I'm not afraid to admit that. I'm not afraid to admit that I'm not some spiritual giant. I'm a man like you that's just trying to serve God and please God. And I love people and I want to bless people. But I want God to be pleased in the process and don't want to become about me. I want to stay about Him. And so in order for me to stay on track, I need to know, make me to know my end. And the measure of my days. What it is that I may know how frail I am. I know someday I will not be here. I know someday that I won't be behind the pulpit anymore. And someday God's going to call me home. And I've got to make sure, before I get there, I've got to make sure that I have been able to work hard to unravel the mystery of who I am as a person so I don't stand in the way of my eternity. Nobody else can ever stand in the way of my eternity. Only I can stand in the way. Nobody can rob from me what God has given me. Nobody can keep me from being a praying man. Nobody can keep me from being a fasting man. Nobody can keep me from living a life of righteousness. I am the only one that can get in the way of being the child of God that I want to be. In order for me to be that person, I've got to spend my lifetime unraveling the mystery of who I am. And that's going to happen when God reminds me every day. You know, we pray a lot sometimes for God to heal us. And I'll be honest with you, I struggle where to find the balance in that prayer, and I'll tell you why. Because I know there are some pains that God ain't taking away. I know that. You know why? That pain reminds me you're getting older. You're getting closer to the end of your days. Now, you think I'm being funny? I'm being serious. Heart attack. If that wasn't the case, why would we deal with those things? See, when you're young, you don't think about that stuff. You get older, man. You think about death all the time. I mean, maybe you don't. I do. And I know I'm only 48, but man, I do. I think about it. And you know what that does to me? I kind of need to walk this narrow road. I don't want to get off the narrow path. Right. Broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. It's easy to go to hell. I don't want to go that route. I want to be smart. I want to be wise. If I don't feel like praying, tough luck, Chuck. You got to pray, man. Yeah. You probably need to pray now because you don't feel like praying anyway. So you're going to have to get in the prayer room. If I don't feel like going to church, oh, well, you need to be there. You need to hear the word of God. You need to know. Oh, shit.
Come on.
He goes on to say, behold, thou hast made my days as a handbreadth, and mine age is as nothing before thee. Verily, every man at his best state is altogether vanity. Selah. Surely, every man walketh in vain. In a vain show, surely they are disquieted in vain. He heapeth up the riches and knoweth not who shall gather them. Think about that. He heapeth up the riches and knoweth not. I mean, I don't know. Thank God for people that leave an inheritance, you know what I'm saying? But no one's ever left me one, just for the record, just in case you'd like to. I've never been left anything. But the fact of the matter is, we ain't take nothing with us. You can pile it all up. You can bury it in your backyard. You can put it in stocks and bonds if God takes you tomorrow. Nothing. You'd be lucky if they even buy you a coffin that looks good. Really. You better have a good honorable person picking out your coffin. They'd be like, $1,500, $5,000. No, that comes out of my pocket. You get the $1,500 when you ain't got nobody anyway. You think people won't be that way? Oh, yes, they will. I've seen wars start before the last breath was breathed. I mean, wars. We had one in our church years ago. It's the most disturbing thing. You can come get ready for me, honey, if you don't mind. It's the most disturbing. She's laying there in her living room on her deathbed. She died that day. I'm telling you, they're upstairs pocketing jewelry. Pocketing. And then the will disappeared. And then there was a war to this day. The kids have nothing to do with each other. Nothing. They blew all their... I told the mother. Here, you want to know who I am? I'll tell you who I am. I told the mother a couple years before that. I said, if I were you, I said, honestly, I wouldn't leave nothing to my kids but a little bit of money. I said, because they're going to blow it and they're going to turn on each other. So I told them. I knew who they were. It's exactly what I told her. You can think I'm cynical. You can think whatever I want to. But exactly what I said happened.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah. Why? Because money can ruin people. Yeah,
sure can.
But you know... When we live these words that David speaks. You know, we don't take any day for granted. We thank God for every day. And not only thank God, but if I've got business to attend to, I need to do it today in case I'm not here tomorrow. I've told this story in Jefferson a lot. But when we were just a couple years married, it was probably in 2000, 2001, so maybe 3 years, 2.5, I don't know. And one night, I don't know what happened to me, but this ungodly fear came over me. And I felt like I was going to die that night. I mean, it was so bad that I couldn't shake it all evening. I went to bed, and she's laying in bed. She's sound asleep, and I'm praying, and I'm crying. I'm sobbing before the Lord. I said, God, just let me wake up tomorrow so I can buy more life insurance. That was my prayer. I was all messed up. But I'm like, I can't leave this poor woman with nothing. And so I woke up the next morning. I thanked the Lord, and I bought more life insurance. You think I'm kidding? You better believe I did. I still tear up thinking about it, but I realized every day is a blessing. I don't want to squander this blessing. If I've got problems, if I've got challenges, my God, my goal in 2021 is going to be to unravel the mystery of me. Unravel my mystery. Not worry about anybody else any longer. Not focus on everybody else. Not worry about who did what and who said what. I'm sorry if I'm boring you, but I feel pretty strongly about this. And David goes on to say, and now, Lord, what wait I for? My hope is in thee. Deliver me from all my transgressions. Make me not the reproach of the foolish. I was dumb, I opened not my mouth because thou didst it. Remove thy stroke away from me. I am consumed by the blow of thine hand. When thou with rebukes dost correct man for iniquity, thou makest his beauty to consume away like a moth. Surely every man is vanity, Selah. That's why the scripture says open rebuke is better than secret love. Open rebuke has a way of humbling us. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear unto my cry. Hold not thy peace at my tears, for I am a stranger with thee and a sojourner as all my fathers were. O spare me, that I may recover strength before I go hence and be no more. So, let me try and pull this together with this one thought. Reason. You know the scripture, the Bible says in Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. There's something about tucking ourselves away, just me and the Lord, and talking. See, you can't talk so much when you pray. We spend our whole prayer meetings asking God, do this, do that, send me this, send me that. And all the while, the Lord, have you ever been in a conversation and they're talking so much, you're like, just give me a small window. And I'm going to say something like I got to go, and that small window never even comes. You ever been in that? Raise your hand. Okay. I mean, I'll be like this. I just had one recently. I don't remember who it was. I'm like, just give me one window. And there'd be like a brief pause, and I'm like, and they start talking again. This is my opportunity. I'm stuck here. That's probably the Lord most of the time. You shut up and let me talk a little bit.
Really?
I mean, my favorite experiences as a Christian is when the Lord speaks to me. There's nothing in the world that I will ever treasure when I leave this earth more than the voice of God in this actual, this thing that I shared with you, I've always been a little, I always want to make sure if the Lord says something and I say, thus saith the Lord, that it was the Lord and I'm not making this up in my head. So on this particular day, I wrote it all down. And I said, God, I don't want to speak on your behalf if this really isn't you. And the Lord said, speak, because I have put my words in your mouth. They have sown the most valuable seed, time. I don't even know what that meant. And they will reap what they've sown. And then he went on to say a couple of things. And so it was refreshing. I love. I know every place in this county that God has spoken to me. I can take you to the spot. And there's a lot of them. But you see, until we really work hard to unravel our own mystery, and we understand that it really will only come about when we start letting the Lord speak. So, I would like to challenge you for this upcoming year to spend some time and reason with the Lord. And say, Lord, what did you get to say in 2020? I was all upset over coronavirus. I was all upset over the stupid lockdowns. I was all upset because this happened and because that happened. And I let you know I was upset, God. And I asked you a million times to change this and change that. But what have you not got to say? You know, I was thinking recently about Matthew and the many scriptures that warn us that false prophets will arise and deceive many. And I thought about that. I thought, well, how would that all come about? Well, it became very clear to me. When you want something bad enough and somebody speaks it, you know, it's easy. They say what you're feeling, oh, must be the Lord. I had a lady message me this week. She attended our church a couple times over the years. Once in a while, she messaged me. She says, Pastor, can you just give me some advice? I don't know what to do. She said, I have this friend, and I see her a lot, and I love her dearly, but everything that happens is the Lord. It's a sign from God. She says, she found a raisin on the floor in the church, and she said it was a sign from God. And she starts naming this litany of stupid things. She said, I'm telling you everything. I said, no, you're right. I'd run from someone like that. I'd run. Because those people... Only a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. Those people make themselves ripe for false prophets. Ripe. What's that got to do with you and I? I think God has some things to say to us. I really do. Not necessarily bad. But I really believe, and I'm sorry if I'm boring you, I'll finish. I really believe that we are entering into a time where God wants to speak to his children more than ever. And maybe clear some things up. It's not always what we want. It's not always what we're hoping for. Sometimes it's the complete opposite. But to understand and know that, you know, God's still in this thing. And not just because we say it, because the Lord has given some form of reassurance. But that takes people that are willing to unravel their own mysteries in their own lives and not allow those things to consume them. And why don't you stand with me real quick if you don't mind. This is just the spirit of the matter of what I felt when I came in here today. Wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and spiritual wickedness in high places. It's not about what someone does, what someone says. It's not about how mean they were or how nasty they are. It's about this wicked battle sometimes that rages in the spirit and that affects us. And for me to do what God is, and my focus, my mission is to do what God has called me to be, I've got to
pray the prayer of Job, pray the prayer of David. I've got to say, Lord, you got to show me myself. You got to point me out. You got to highlight me. Forget about everybody else. Me. I want to know more about me. That should be our prayer. That should be our prayer. Why did I do this, God? Why do I struggle with this, God? Why does this always happen to me, God? Chances are, God may be trying to get your attention. You may be walking into your own messes. Isn't it funny? We can so easily see somebody else, but we can't see ourselves half the time. So easy. I have people tell me all the time, someone can call me up and they're all down, and I can say, well, this and that, and you have to encourage them in the Lord when it comes to me. I can't do that for my own self. I need the Lord. Brother Tyler, why don't you come and sing for us? If you feel even in any way the Lord has spoken to you, you come to the front unless you don't feel comfortable. And I mean COVID comfortable. If you just not want to get out of your seat, we don't care if you're uncomfortable there. Elijah, the fire and the wind, the earthquake, God was in none of those. Sometimes I think as Christians we have gotten addicted to the Big Bang services. And we no longer can allow God to just speak to us in a small, but in the silence. There the Lord begins to speak to him. Sometimes we just need the Lord to bring things down and let him have his way. I know the Lord loves us. But he loves us enough to not leave us where we are. And he loves us enough to allow us to point out our own faults and failures and bring them before heaven and say, God, help me. If you just pray this prayer and I'm done, help me be a better person tomorrow, a better child of God, a better wife, a better husband, a better Christian than I was today. And tomorrow you pray that prayer again and let it become a daily prayer in your life, and you will see God change you for the better. Nobody else, just you. Amen. Go ahead, Brother Tyler.
Is all you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Come under the glory of God. God. But you know what? We got a God. We have a God who's merciful, who's good, who's kind. And most of all, he's forgiving. He will forgive us. Hallelujah. That's the kind of God that I serve. Hallelujah. He's a forgiving God. Yes, we got problems. We wrestle things, and Satan will come in. Hallelujah. And one of the most things that he does is he uses the eye gate. He uses, hallelujah, the smelling gate. You ever been around somebody in the world? I did this thing. If he smelled good, hi. People do that, but see, people don't think that it can happen in the church, but it can. Because the devil is right there in the church while we're raising our hands and praising the Lord. So we got to put our mind. See, the mind is a terrible thing to waste. But if he gets in your mind, he's got you. So this year, I've been reflecting on this. I've been fasting and praying because of things that Pastor Adarius talked about that I went through as a child. I was raised in the bar, okay? I was raised in the bar. My mother and my auntie, they both was alcoholics. But when they got saved, they left that world behind. And when my mother passed away, hallelujah, she knew, hallelujah, the Lord in the pardon of her sin. Hallelujah. She died in my arms. And she said, Nita, she said, I'm not going to make it to the doctors. I was telling Sister Gwen that today. And she said, bam, she went right down in my arms. And I couldn't pick her up to get her off the floor. Hallelujah. But God sent a man to the house who delivers our medicine to help me. You see how God works. But look at the things that he's brought you through this year. This is what I want to say to you. I've been through some things myself this year. Emotionally and physically. I don't mind talking about it. Because if I don't have someone else, hallelujah, that I can go to Pastor Adar and talk to them without them, the whole congregation knowing it. Sometimes the whole congregation might need to know it, depending on what it is. But if I can't have confidence in somebody to talk to, that's where Satan comes in. And he destroys our walk with God. Don't let him do that to you this year. Whatever the problem is, it's not too hard to solve. It's not too hard for God to say, I love you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Hallelujah. Come unto me. All ye that are heavy laden. Heavy laden with what? Sin? Yes. Heavy laden with emotional problems? Yes. Whatever it might be, God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly more than we're able to ask or even to think. Amen. You're thinking, he can't do nothing for this? But yes, he can. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Let him strengthen me.
Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for this word, Lord Jesus, Lord. Yes, Lord, as we move forward, Lord, help us unravel the mystery, Lord, that lies within ourselves, Lord. Those things, Lord, that we struggle with. Those things, Lord, that we deny in ourselves, Lord Jesus. Lord, may you peel back the layers in this coming year, Lord. Show us, Lord, our weaknesses, Lord. And better yet, Lord, show us how to strengthen them. Strengthen ourselves, Lord, to fit better in the body, Lord. We give you glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.